written down a general method for solving kinematics of rigid bodies under planar motion problems. And in that method, the very first step was to choose between a translating versus a rotating reference frame. And at that point, I said that, you know, don't worry about rotating reference frame. Pretty much every frame that we are going to deal with at that point in time were going to be just the translating frames. So there was no rotating reference frame. But now that we've seen them, the first step would be to really determine which kind of frame to use. So let's write that down. General method for solving planar rigid body motion problems. Okay, and step one now. So this general method would essentially supersede the method that I gave to you before. So the method that I'm going to write right now will apply for the previous kinds of problems as well, where you use a translating reference frame. So step one is to decide between translating versus rotating frame. So for that, I'm going to give you a test, okay? A simple test is to see if there is sliding happening over a rotating body. Now, pay attention to this. This is saying sliding happening over a rotating body. So which means that if you pick a rigid body in the system that is given to you, on that particular rotating body, there should be some sort of sliding or relative motion occurring, okay? So let me give you an example. So this is an example. Let's say I have an actuator, okay? And it's connected to a rotating body like that, right? So this is a hinge, this is a hinge, this is a hinge, and this is a slider. So which means that the slide is really allowed to, this particular piston or slider is allowed to move back and forth as this rotates, okay? So which means that essentially the distance between, let's say this point is O, this point is P, this point is Q, distance between O and P is changing. Okay, so would this call for use of a rotating reference frame or a translating reference frame? This would call for a rotating reference frame because you have a rigid body OP over here, which is rotating. And on this rotating rigid body, there is sliding happening. This piston is sliding on this rotating rigid body. Another way of looking at this is to see that the distance between the two points on the rigid bodies between which there is a relative motion is going to be changing, and you want to relate the velocity of those two points. So for example, if I want to relate the velocity of the point O with the velocity of the point P, then the distance between O and P is actually changing. This R is changing. That doesn't happen for a rigid body where you are trying to relate the velocity and acceleration between the two points, because by definition, the distance between the two points on a rigid body does not change. But here now you're trying to relate the motion, you're trying to relate the velocity and acceleration of the two points on two separate rigid bodies, but there is a relative motion between the two. Another example. So this is a situation where we have a crank and we have a connecting rod and the piston is allowed to slide in this direction, right? So would this call for a rotating reference frame? Do we have sliding happening on a rotating rigid body? Yes, we do have sliding happening, but this sliding is happening on a fixed link. This is not a rotating rigid body. So this is not a rotating body, which means that in this case, you should be using a translating frame. And in this case, we should be using a rotating frame. So the test says that if there is sliding happening over a rotating rigid body, then use a rotating frame. So use rotating frames. Otherwise, you can use translating frame. Then the next question is, okay, if this test is passed and we have to use a rotating frame, how should we show it? How should we align it? So one of the thumb rules is you can definitely choose any direction you want for showing the rotating reference frame, but one of the thumb rules says that you align your rotating frame with the rotating rigid body, primarily because in the rotating frame, In that case, writing relative velocity and relative acceleration expressions becomes simpler. So, for example, for the first problem over here, I will actually align my rotating reference frame this way. Okay, so because in this reference frame, when I'm doing the analysis, when I write the relative velocity of the point P with respect to O, it will be along this direction. So V relative in this case would be simply V relative I hat. On the other hand, if I pick my rotating reference frame this way, if I showed it this way, then I would have to worry about what this angle is, and I would have to resolve this relative velocity along these directions. Okay, let me call it X prime, Y prime. All right, but then you have to keep in mind that once you show your reference frame in one direction, so the red one is how I'm picking, then every vector quantity, every position vector, every velocity, every acceleration has to be written with respect to that reference frame. In fact, that's one of the commonly made mistakes by the students. So I'm going to come back and repeat that point once again when I'm solving the problem. Okay, so let's get back to our method. So the first step is to decide between translating versus rotating frame. And the test for deciding between the two is to recognize that there is sliding happening over a rotating rigid body. Now, this test actually works most of the time, but there are some situations when you wouldn't see any sliding happening over a rotating rigid body, but you can still use, you know, the equations that we have derived before. So another example is, let's say I have, you know, a merry-go-round, right? So this can be seen as a disc, and there is a person standing over here, and this person is, you know, fixed with respect to the merry-go-round. So as this merry-go-round rotates, this person is also rotating. And this merry-go-round is in a park, and there is a walkway in the park, and there is another person who's walking here. So let's call this person A, this person B, and this person is actually walking this way, right? So in a situation like this, if somebody said, can you tell me what is the velocity, relative velocity of B as seen by A? It turns out for problems like these, use of rotating reference frame becomes important. Because what you have over here is the reference frame. If you attach your reference frame to A, which is what you would have to do if you're looking for, let's say, relative velocity of B. So I'm looking for relative velocity of B as seen by A. And what is that quantity? That is basically V relative. So the question is, what is V relative? And if you try to use your previous knowledge of comparing the relative velocity by saying this relative velocity is Vb equal to Va plus V relative. In a sense, you are writing this as a velocity of B versus A. This would be wrong because the relative velocity in this case is actually not equal to Vb over A, which is simply Vb minus Va. So if you simply did the subtraction between the velocity B, and that may be given to you as seen by an inertial reference frame or a stationary observer. So let's say this is my stationary or primary reference frame, and you subtract it with the velocity of A, which you could also determine because you know the angular velocity, you know the distance between the two, then you would be making a mistake because that is not the velocity as seen by A. Why this is not correct? This is an important point that may surprise you if you're coming with even with a strong physics background, because you have attached your reference frame to A, which is actually rotating with the disc or the merry-go-round. This relationship where relative velocity is simply subtraction between the two velocity is valid only when you have a translating reference frame. So if you wanted to solve this problem, you would have to solve this problem by attaching a moving reference frame to A like this, and then you would have to use your equations which relate these two velocities in the following way. Velocity of B equal to velocity of A plus omega cross R of B with respect to A plus V relative. And it is this V relative that you are looking for. Now, in this case, if you look at this, we are using rotating frame equations, but there is no sliding happening on a rotating rigid body, at least not in the sense that we have understood it so far, right? Because B is really not on A. Yet there is sliding happening in the sense that the distance between A and B is actually changing. The distance, so as A rotates, the B is maybe farther from A, right? So if let's say A comes here and B is over here, the distance between A and B has changed, right? So there is relative motion between B and A, and A itself is actually mounted on a rotating rigid body, and that's why you have this term as well. So in this particular case, if you were really interested in calculating the relative velocity, it would be VB minus VA minus omega cross R of B with respect to A. So you do subtract VB from VA, but then you also subtract the rotational term. Okay, so step one was deciding what kind of reference frame to pick, translating versus rotating. And then step two is to show the frame. Okay, so let's write that. Step two show the primary as well as moving reference frames. And as much as possible, you should align moving reference frame with rotating body. Okay, so step three would be similar to what we did before, which is to identify the motions of various rigid bodies. So actually from this point onward, the method is same as what we have seen before. Identify common points on the rigid bodies. Write velocity and acceleration expressions for common points. And the idea is that you're writing velocity and acceleration of the common points from the perspectives of different rigid body, from the perspective of different bodies. Step six is to equate those perspectives. What that means is that you will equate the velocity and acceleration expression for the common points. And finally, you will solve for unknowns. Okay, so in general, if you're writing the velocity and acceleration expression in the xy plane, there will be a long I hat and j hat direction. So in turn, they would reduce to two scalar equations. So you will be able to solve for two unknowns. So if you have one vector equation, that will reduce to two scalar equations from which you can solve for two unknowns. So you need to identify the variables, you need to identify the unknowns, and you have to make sure that your number of unknowns are same as number of equations. So if you have four unknowns, then you have to generate two vector equations, or in turn, four scalar equations.